Hey y'all, it is your favorite nerdy girl here, Nerdy Girl Reviews, aka Roz Baron, and we are back with another recap review for Candy, currently streaming on Hulu. If you'd like to see and hear my full commentary, keep me locked here on YouTube. If you're watching this on Instagram, click on the link in bio. If you're watching this on IG Stories, click on the link. It'll link you back to my YouTube channel. I'm also available on TikTok under Nerdy Girl Reviews. And if you'd like to catch my other recaps and reviews, you can find me on SofritoForYourSoul.com. Let's get into this mini-series review, y'all. Y'all liking the mic? Y'all liking it? All right. Stay tuned. Now, if you're digging the whole wardrobe aesthetic, I thought I would go kind of like Candy's known more for her that curly perm throughout most of the miniseries, but towards the end she has this nice little like coif-like looking blonde, although this is much more contemporary, but again, we work with the elements. And these are not glasses, but are very reminiscent in the 70s merging into 80s attire. So I just thought I would showcase them, but I'm going to take them off as we get into the review. But I think I'm doing, you know, I'm a prop queen. I love my props. Y'all know I love my props. Kind of like on the stand type stuff, like I did for my impeachment review, which I will link in the video or in the description box, which you should also catch on Hulu. It was on FX and then it just merges into Hulu, but this mini series was specifically made for Hulu, and we'll get into that. So let's get into this review now. Again, Hulu is not a stranger to their mini series. We've seen a number of other mini series, but it's always played out on a weekly basis. This is the first for Hulu to showcase a miniseries of this type, 6 episodes, and it was nightly. We haven't seen a miniseries like this, very reminiscent of the 80s. I remember in the 80s when there used to be something like really hyped on network television, you would get a whole week's worth of content. And so we're not used to that, or at least this generation is probably like thrown for a loop, like, huh? We get an episode a day? I don't have to wait till next Thursday, Wednesday, Saturday, Sunday. And I kind of miss that old way of TV watching as well. It was a very hyped thing back in the day. People would really like run home and rush home and have their TV dinners and watch. And it felt the way it was shot. Maybe even like the cinematic camera angles and just the feel of the production. It feels very 1980s, very kind of thriller, some psychological thriller, very reminiscent of those cop shows. I forget what that cop show was back in the 80s. Hunter? Something like that back in the day before like Law and Order or anything like that existed. We had Hunter, I remember. I'm dating myself, but nonetheless, those are something. And I don't know, I've always had this interest when it comes to that type of genre. That's why I'm such a big fan of Mindhunter, which FYI, it might be coming back. Please, like, Jonathan Groff was interviewed recently, I think, on the Tonight Show with Jimmy Fallon, one of these Tonight shows, and he made mention that there's a possibility that there might be a season 3 for Mindhunter on Netflix. Oh my god, if so, huh? And speaking of Jonathan Groff, I know this is a big side note, but if you are a fan of his Broadway show, Spring Awakening, which essentially put Jonathan on the map, he went from like Pennsylvania Dutch to like stardom. There's a very endearing documentary of his rise to stardom and all of his fellow cast that went on to do Glee and other shows and are really well known. but we see how that evolution occurred and for them in terms of their career and how they really made Broadway super interesting. I mean, we already had Rent, but this was like a different spin to it, and you really see how these actors evolved. I mean, they were essentially like babies. So that's currently streaming on HBO Max. I may do a review on it, but we'll see. So some background. Hulu's new drama, Candy, tells the story of Candy Montgomery, Candace, Candy for short, y'all, a seemingly well-adjusted Texas housewife with a husband and two children who was accused of killing her friend Betty Gore with an axe in 1980 and later acquitted by a jury. Texas Monthly articles published in 1984 revealed that Montgomery had been having an affair with Gore's husband, Alan, as a result of her own sexually unsatisfying marriage. But when Gore confronted Montgomery about the affair in June 1980, which, side note, was on June 13th, very reminiscent of Friday the 13th, because it was a Friday. That year was a Friday. A violent struggle ensued, leaving Gore, also mother of two, dead, and with 41 axe wounds on her body. In the new Hulu show, Jessica Biel stars as Montgomery, while Melanie Lynskey plays Gore, Pablo Schreiber and Timothy Simmons appear as Alan Gore and Montgomery's husband Pat, respectively. Fans of the series might be wondering what happened to the real-life Montgomery after her acquittal, and what became of Gore's two children after her death. On the heels of the Candy finale on Friday, here's what we know about the whereabouts of Gore's children and Montgomery today. This is an article posted on the insider.com, and I will link that in the description box below. But yes, Miss Candy, this show has been Desperate Housewives gone loco. And we see it's like a bunch of Christian folks, and again, no shade to Christianity. Everybody has their faith. Everybody has their concept and moral compass on how they survive. It's always funny to me, though, these are mostly conservative folk who vote conservative and will have the most scandalous of lives. Seemingly, this looks like a typical, normal, boring suburban home. So a suburban neighborhood with a cul-de-sac and everything. And, you know, little to no crime, family-oriented neighborhood. And, you know, it's the type of town that will house, you know, X amount of residents that nearly everybody knows you from birth, probably. And even if you've moved, they know who you are. And that's what we see in the first episode. The first episode isn't a breakdown of their lives. That's more weaving into the second episode. The first episode is titled Friday the 13th because everything happened on Friday the 13th. I think there was mention in the courtroom how things were related to it being like an unlucky number. That's superstition, which I don't understand how people are religious and will still have these superstitions on certain things like numbers. An indication that something is gone wrong, that it fell on June 13th. And it's so funny because I don't think they make mention of that movie, because the attention was going more towards Star Wars. On that particular day, the Montgomerys, who were, you know, doing their typical errands, living their typical life, were taking care of Betty Gore's eldest child, which was a little girl who was friends with Candy's eldest child. She had like, I think, two or three kids. And so her daughter was friends with Betty's daughter. Betty's the neighbor. And again, they're all neighbors. And since they were getting along smashingly and they had already been taking care of her for most of the weekend, they were like, well, you know, maybe you'll have fun because we're going to go see Star Wars and we'd like you to come. So the child is elated, but she has swimming lessons. Her mother always has like X amount of stuff lined up and scheduled for her children, and one of them was a swimming lesson. So she's like, but I didn't bring my suit. So Candy being the, I don't know, sometimes I feel like Candy was semi-robotic because, look, I get it. Some women can take to motherhood like a duck to a water, but not in every case. And though here she is, the more svelte of the two women, and she looks like Bionic Woman who can do nearly everything. Superwoman. She could do the lunches. She could fry up a pan. She could do, she could get the kids ready and wrangled and take them to Bible study and all this nonsense and have a baked lasagna and start another business at the same time, which I think up until this point she had been a housewife. But before she married, again, I did my digging, and before she married, she was a secretary, I think, on a naval kind of, you know, naval, I don't know, I can't even describe it, but it was like something that had to do with like the Navy. And nonetheless, and I think she was an Army brat because I think her father had been in the Army for X amount of years. So that's how she was able to like weave and transition into the workforce. And she happens to meet her husband. I don't know. I don't know if she met him in school and he's the one. Well, something was related. And that's how her, I think her husband was working as a, is it a aviator? Engineer, something related to planes. So once they married, she became the housewife, and obviously perhaps the boring housewife because their sex life wasn't super interesting. And although they were finding different ways to find to keep the passions alive, you know, it was the typical boring life. Mommy does this, mommy does that, wife does this. So, but I'm going into a tangent. Episode one, we see basically what instances of what happened. We don't have a clear definition towards the end, but we see like that time schedule. And we've seen this in other crime stories, like this happened at this hour, this happened at this hour. Perhaps again, these are instances of what came out in the courtroom and how things were documented. And you could see that, yes, Candy had called Betty and had let her know that she needed a swimsuit for her daughter and that she was ready to pick it up at what time. And Betty already kind of looks muffled and annoyed. And she said, well, 12 works best for me. So she's like, okay, great, whatever. And she was mentioning that as her daughter does her diving post under getting her head under the water to kind of give her some positive reinforcement, she gives her a peppermint. So they agreed upon 12. She's wrangling the kids. They're excited about Star Wars. Real no mention of Friday the 13th. And so she gets to the church. The kids are doing, you know, their classes, and there's a pageant and everything. But for some reason, even though she's doing like 16 other things, she still finds the time to like, well, you know what? I think now would be perfect. It's 10 o'clock. 10 a.m. She said this would be perfect timing to get the bathing suit as opposed to 12 like Betty had said. And Betty's going through her own thing because you can see that she's having issues with Alan. Alan always leaves. And I think that was a good portion of the reason why they had troubles in their marriage. It seemingly on the outside looked perfect and ideal, but it wasn't. And Betty felt abandoned a good portion of the time. So she had just given birth to their second child, and it's a little girl. I think that the child's about a year old, but still, you know, it's tough. Especially, which I'm not 100% clear on if the child was colicky, but that's hard when you don't have a partner to help you and just would prefer to be on the road. There are instances where the child is crying nonstop, and here she is doing her best to keep the child clean and dry and changing its diapers. And it's back in the day, so you can see like she has like the little pins and stuff. That's hard. We're not talking about even like the contemporary Pampers that you could just like the Velcro. No. And she's kind of telling him like, why do you always leave? This is hard. And he's kind of like shrugging it off. And in fact, when she's dealing with the child, he's having his breakfast. He's having his breakfast, scratching his behind, opening his newspaper, which again, this was, you know, typical. This is what you would see in most marriages. Men didn't really necessarily pitch in. It was like the woman's job to take care of everything. And this is the South, and this is Texas, North Texas, but nonetheless, like, he just didn't feel compelled, even though he was a nice man, to help. So she's frustrated. She's resentful towards him. She looks upset, like something's up. And so he's left. He's gone. He's gone to work, and then he soon goes to some retreat related, supposedly, to the job. And she's upset. She's trying to cope with her child, the baby at least, and the new puppy that they just got. And here comes Candy with her nonsense, trying to pick up the bathing suit, being obnoxious as always. Y'all! Seemingly perfect, little Miss Barbie housewife. And you see that the door closes. And I love, again, kudos to the set directors of getting every detail that looked really of that time period. It's definitely a time capsule when it comes to like the shag carpeting, the horrible prints for the sofas. I remember those too, and they were huge then. You kind of go like, why did people like that velvet to the touch? But very, very of that time. And so Betty, you can see Betty's annoyed. The door slams, it fades out, goes to commercial, and then before you know it, Candy runs out and pulls out. You can tell that she's kind of shaking, wet, and then you can see that as she's pulling into her own driveway that there's a huge cut on her forehead. She's hobbling. There's another cut on her foot, and then she's running into the house. She is wet herself, but then she goes in and further cleans. She cleans her clothes. She takes off everything. And gets dried, changes her shoes, and runs out and goes back to the church to pick up her kids. And her own child was like, where's my mom, my mother? Because there was like a whole pageant that had to do something with Noah's Ark or something. And she was like, and then she's like so nervous. You can see she's out of whack. She has this certain thing that she keeps telling everybody, like that she has rehearsed since probably she left Betty's home. We just see all these instances and cuts, and you can see something has happened, but nobody's like giving us the full details to the spectators, at least. And she's in her home. No, I'm sorry. She's at the church, and as they're exiting, you could tell she can't even see Betty's kid. She can't stare at Betty's kid in the eyes, as if she's feeling guilty already. And but the thing is that life carried on for Miss Candy soon after that, whatever happened in that home. And she takes the child to her swimming lesson, gets them all prepared. Then they head to the theater. They sit through a long movie because Lord knows Star Wars is long. And there are instances where you hear like the kids talking about injuring each other, cutting each other's hands, stuff like that. And she, again, it conjures up some sense of repression and resentment and guilt, and she starts throwing up. Nobody's seeing it, but somebody, mostly her closest of friends, notice something's wrong with her, and that she's just like somebody who was just like so put together seems like something's off, and she keeps repeating the same thing over and over and over again. Now before Betty's, you know, alleged at this point demise, she did manage to call her husband's boss to complain about why is he always on call, why is he always on leave. And then I think he tries to call her back or lets her know, you can't be doing this. This is bad. Looks bad on me. And as he tries to call her back, she's upset. Because I think even though they've been going through marital issues, they are trying to work on their marriage. And he promises her that once he's done with this particular retreat, that they're going to go on like maybe a second honeymoon. And they're going to go back to when they were younger and they had traveled. And, Yeah, you know, they were rekindling that. And then he also gets some traveler's checks and whatnot. But when he tries to call her back to let her know of the status, she's not available, or she lowered, like, you could see at least in these particular scenes before Candy came over that she lowered the volume on the phone, and she was in the middle of doing, like, some dresses, I think, for her daughters. So there's a sewing machine, you see all these materials. And, you know, you're kind of wondering what exactly did happen in that home. Now, after X amount of hours of her husband, Alan, trying to call Betty and no answer. Remember, this is not a time where there was a cell phone, a smartphone, so there was no way of tracking people. You literally had to keep dialing. And remember the rotary phones? Oh, my Lord. It was just a minute just to roll that dang number. And he calls the neighbors because he's just desperate. He's like, it's not typical of her to not answer. So after three or four tries, he finally caves and calls the neighbor and says, look, do me the favor, can you check on my wife? And the neighbor in particular, which I think he still lives. I think I found an interview where the man still lives. It's amazing. And I'll link that also in the description box below. But after all these years, to like close to 40 some odd years, the man's still alive. But he initially went to go tap over their, you know, their door to see if the lady's okay. He noticed that a car was missing, so he's like, I think she's out. And then again, yet another try, and Alan still can't locate his wife. So he tells him, like, please just go over again, I feel like something's wrong. He heads back and then realizes that the car had been pushed into their drive, their garage, and that the door had been unlocked this entire time. And then I think Alan had called two other neighbors, and so they were there to investigate. And then we see them, you know, inside. One of the neighbors had like a handgun just in case. I think they may have heard like the baby crying, and they realized that the child had been crying most of the day. And I think there's articles where it says that because the child had been crying most of the day and not attended, she had gone hoarse from crying so much. And then they go and they look over. They don't see anything, but they see these disturbances of, like, the material, the sewing machine, whatnot, things knocked on the floor, a card that says Cover Girls on, like, one of their desks or coffee tables. And then they head to the utility room, where I guess you would keep the laundry and soaps and whatnot, and they see a body full of blood, and their assumption is that she was shot. So they let Alan know, I think that there was an intruder, and she was shot. And she's probably died from the loss of blood. Now, this is how, and all of the eerie music that you hear in the background is definitely from Friday the 13th to kind of coincide. And also when they started their police investigation, they realized also that there was a newspaper with the date June 13th, and the newspaper was on the page for the movie section, and it was The Shining, which again we know Jack Nicholson's character and how again he was an axe murderer or tries to injure his family with an axe. And everything, and all of this played out in court, believe it or not. It all played out in court. And then I think it took 13 hours to locate Betty Gore, and that it took 13 days for the real culprit to come forward. So I had all of these, like, connections and interconnections to this particular superstition. Go figure. Now, going into episode 2, Happy Wife, Happy Life, we get more of a background on these two ladies. And the thing also, before I move into episode 2, knowing what Candy had done, pretending to be oblivious. And again, I don't know if she was really like in shock of what happened, but for her to have carried out a whole routine full of errands and whatnot, And I think even Alan called her at her home because they were that close of friends. And for heaven's sake, he had his child staying in her house. And she acts oblivious. Oh, I hope you find her. Do you need me to go over? Blah, 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 blah. But they insisted on her not going, which was probably better. Because, again, had she probably would have gotten rid of evidence and whatnot. So, going into the second episode, you see how both women are in their romantic relationships with their husbands, and also how the community sees them. And, we see a very bored housewife. She's very interesting. She's very charming, Miss Candy. But we can see that she's also very frustrated with her husband, Pat. And she loves these, like, you know, remember back in the day, those, like, really raunchy, romance novels that gave bored housewives, like, imagination and, you know what kind of material. And and we see that because Candy is bored. She tries. It's not like she doesn't attempt it with her husband, but he's as cold as a fish. Which it also makes you think, like, how did they have children? Because it was like she's laying these clues pretty clear, like, hey, I want to get it on. And he's kind of like, oblivious. Or, look, my show's about to come on. She's like, hello. Having to read dirty romance novels so she can get off. Poor girl. She's bored. She's bored to tears. And although she has her choir, she has her faith, but, you know, she has her desires that are not being met. But again, she is part of the neighborhood. She's part of her community. They esteem her. Betty, on the other hand, is not so well liked. She isn't originally from Texas. She moved there not too long ago with her husband. So she's kind of already seen as the outsider, and not a lot of people are gravitating towards her. We see that she was a school teacher, and she, because of